tonight. Hear myself talking. Something wasn't working, and I'm wondering. I have it, but I have a.
That's the other one. I got this one.
Oh. Okay. All right,
so I'm going to go ahead and start talking. Are we on broadcasting?
Yep.
All right, cool. All right, hope you're here for WordPress, Arizona WordPress Meetup, because that's what we're talking about. If you're with someone else, you can stay because we're a friendly group, but my name is Carol Stambaugh, and I'm the one of the organizers of the Meetup group. We have now, when you look at our Meetup group, we've got 930 members all over the state of Arizona, so we are pretty big. You can say not all of them come, but we do a lot of broadcasting. Like, we will broadcast this through YouTube, and our YouTube videos are getting some hits, and many of the people that you see here, the organizers that are a part of this meetup also are the organizers from WordCamp, Phoenix WordCamp. And so, since we're talking about WordCamp, I'll go ahead and give that little pitch. WordCamp is coming up in January. It's not that far away. The speaker submissions will be open on our website very soon. Like probably any day now. And the website for our WordCamp is 2014.phoenix.wordcamp.org. So it's the year .phoenix.wordcamp.org. So check out the website. Make sure that you plan to attend because WordCamp is a pretty amazing weekend. Who all here, has anyone here been to WordCamp? All right, so we've got some people who will attest. It's pretty fun, it's pretty awesome, a lot of good information, so make sure you save the dates. Before, we have another event that's even earlier, which is Twestival. Anyone heard of Twestival?
Yay,
Twestival. Yay! Eileen, you're on the planning committee. Will you please come up here and talk about it? Because I was going to pinch hit for Chris. But you would be better able to speak about Twestival than I, so come on up.
Oh, my God, I don't know how that happened. I think it's because I got a couple things from the auction, that's why. All right, so Twestival is Tuesday night in Scottsdale. Just go ahead and Google Twestival Phoenix. It benefits Teen Lifeline, which is a teen crisis 800 number. They teach teens to be peer counselors. So really great, very local charity. So you know how you go to some of these charity events and they're rubber chicken and you listen to all these people and my God, why am I here? It's not like that at all. It's all about food, music, fun, unstructured, more networking, great way to meet up with a bunch of other people who are technologically inclined. So we encourage you to come, get a really nifty t-shirt where you get your Twitter handle printed on the back. So just go ahead and Google Festival Phoenix, and you'll find out all the information there. Look forward to it.
Thank you! I'm looking forward to it, too. It's going to be a lot of fun. There's a lot of people here at Gangplank who put a lot of work into it, and so it's a great event. 100% volunteer. All the proceeds go to the charity, so definitely check it out. All right, so we're going to get straight into our speaker because I want to be able to free him and let him go whenever he's done. If you were here about 2 or 3 months ago, Jeremy did a piece on HTML, and he did such a great job. I mean, he really can take this information and break it down in great terms for someone who's new to code and a beginning user of WordPress. And WordPress, while it is just the perfect platform for those who don't know how to code, when you don't know HTML or CSS, you quickly go, and you're at a wall. And you want to do something, and you know that there's a way to do it, and you can't figure out how to do it, oftentimes the answer is in CSS. And so knowing even a little bit and understanding how CSS works, and then good old-fashioned Google, how do I do this in CSS, between those two things, will take you a long way. And so Jeremy's going to do just a really casual walkthrough so that you can hopefully understand CSS better, and that then you can take your education even further with whatever needs you have on your site. When you come to a site and you're like, that, there's too much space here, too much padding. You know, where do I go to find that? And then you all of a sudden can start solving your own problems. And it's so exciting when you get to that point. It's very cool. So Jeremy is going to...
I'm trying.
Should I talk longer? Should I dance?
Yeah, talk for another second. Why can't I switch these screens?
Jeremy is, he actually does a lot of the front end or the styling work on WordPress websites. He's very, very skilled at CSS. And then he also has a position. He's the founder and owner of Bonanza Educational that does really cool after-school programming for youth in Arizona. They go into different school districts and they do after-school enrichment programming, and they have programs in districts all over the state. So he does some really, really cool stuff there in addition to his WordPress work. And was at WordCamp San Francisco, gosh, about 3 months ago now. I don't know what else to say, Jeremy.
That's good enough.
All right. So, welcome, Jeremy.
These are really fickle, so hope that's going to be okay. All right, hi again. No fruit this time. No veggies this time if you were here last time. I almost need to move. So my external display port has been breaking on me, so I really want to be careful there. Okay, so I'm back. And I'm going to take it to the next level. So the first couple minutes, I'm going to do a lot of repeating of what I talked about last time, which is cool, because if you weren't here last time, that's awesome for you. If you were here last time, a quick review is not a bad idea. And so before I can really talk about some of the little details of CSS, and it's a lot harder than HTML, I'm going to have to start with explaining a little bit about the architecture of the web again. So I hope you don't mind. What is CSS? It stands for Cascading Style Sheets, and it is the paint job for your website. So if you were here last time, you'll know why I say the paint job, because it's kind of like the paint job for the house that we built with HTML. CSS is the next step of a web standard document. So what is web standards? Web standards are those things that those conventions that we want to follow to make our websites future safe, future proof. We want to write in a way that everybody agrees upon so that as we move into the future, let me see if I can take off my jacket while I'm not stopping talking. So as we move into the future, technology can follow. So web standards are something that are relatively newer still, even though the web itself is very new. Only about the last 5 years have we been doing them, and before that, everybody, each software developer that had a way to access the internet, from AOL to Netscape, had their own way of reading the internet. And so when we write this code, we want to write it in a way so that everybody can read it the same way. And CSS was that next step, in addition to good, proper HTML writing, which we talked about last time, which is available, if I'm not mistaken, on an archive on the Meetup. So I talked a little bit about the web application stack. So there was one day when a website was completely written in one file in one language. And so some of those things that are common from page to page, like, you know, we have the same menu, you would actually have to go and copy that text. And if you had a 20-page site, you would have to copy it to every single one of those 20 documents. And then, oh my gosh, let's add another item to our menu. Well, then we'd have to go in and make a change on one place and then copy it to every 20 sites. So, well, that was a pain in the butt. If we so much as wanted to change a color just a little bit, we'd have to go and copy it everywhere. So, but today, there's quite a few different pieces that go together into what we call the web application stack. And so, to repeat my comparison from last time, let's build a house. If we were to say that the web host, and we all know what a web host is, right? It's that company that you pay monthly to have your website exist out there. If we were to say that web host was the foundation of a house, it has your inputs and outputs into public utilities. On that, we would build the structure of our home, which for our website is HTML. It's putting everything together. It's saying that, hey, our website has rooms. It has a kitchen. It has bedrooms. It has an entryway. So we're going to use CSS as part of this web application stack to paint the walls, to put the stucco on it, to explain what color the tile of roof we're going to have, to say, are we going to have big windows or small windows? Are we going to have wooden doors or metal doors, et cetera, et cetera. And then if you've ever seen some of those interactive things, JavaScript helps make it interactive, and then the back-end languages like PHP, which is what WordPress is built on, does all that saving to the database, like, you know, bringing the electricity up from the ground and sending the sewage out of the house. So, WordPress is a framework that combines a lot of these things that we commonly do, so that all you have to do is come in and just put in content. But if we're going to be a developer, we want to go a little bit beyond that what you see is what you get, or that WYSIWYG from WordPress. And so we want to practice and learn a little bit about CSS, just like a couple months ago we practiced and learned a little bit about HTML, because we want to be able to scratch the surface, make our sites just a little bit more custom. Or if we make this our business, to be able to go in and make something very custom, so that if you have a client that doesn't want to have a WordPress site, with the ease of using WordPress, it can be done. And so being comfortable with CSS also makes you more valuable as a developer, which if we're all in the business of doing development, that makes us more money. Okay? So now that we've done this recap, or for some of us the first time through, I'm going to tell you my rules when I'm talking. First of all, I want you guys to ask lots of questions. I'm going to go through this slowly. I'm going to try and explain this as best as I can. This topic of CSS is a little bit harder to give a good intro to than even HTML was. So please, raise your hand. Please ask questions. And if you want a little bit of advice, if you want something to follow through, if you brought your computer with you, I recommend opening up w3schools.com/css/css or w3.org/style/css. These are great sites to bookmark and read up on. And I cannot impress upon you more that if you're trying to make customizations in CSS, you're going to want to use Google and Stack Overflow and every other resource that's available to us online, because you can be a total expert and not have this memorized. And I am one of those people who will be like, oh, how do I make those curved borders around my objects again? Okay, let's go up and look the exact syntax. It's more powerful to know how to find it than it is to have it memorized, and I can't say that more. Maybe if we were 5-10 years ago and these resources were not available, people memorized them, but back in the day I had a book to reference instead. So, So that actually should say. So CSS is currently being updated. About 8 years ago we got 2.1. I say that about 8 years ago with an asterisk because it's taken Microsoft Internet Explorer about 8 years to implement CSS 2.1. Luckily, we had people like Firefox that had implemented it about 5 years ago, but so it might have been official 8 years ago. But now we're kind of weird. We have an unofficial, in-progress version of CSS 3 that's doing a lot of the cool things that we're seeing changing on websites nowadays, like the curved boxes, like the partial transparencies. And those things are not actually official yet, but now browsers are implementing them before. So let's see, 2.1 took 8 years to be implemented, and 3 is half implemented before it's official, so go figure. So you do want to keep a little bit up on that. And what one to use, actually, it doesn't matter. Back I said in 3 months ago, I said, if you're going to do something with HTML, use HTML5 now on a new project, or continue to use 4 on an old project. What's really neat about CSS and really the awesome vision of it when they came up with it is that it's backward compatible. If a rendering engine or a web browser that's supposed to read the code and turn it into something visible and viewable by your site visitor, if a rendering engine doesn't recognize a rule, it's to skip it. So if you make something really awesome that looks really great in that brand new browser that just came out yesterday that none of your clients use yet, that's okay, because when they finally catch up, that site's just going to keep looking more and more awesome. But if you have one of your clients that still uses, say, Internet Explorer 8 because they haven't upgraded from a Windows XP computer, it's still going to work because it's just going to ignore that enhancement. Okay, so it does not matter what version or what features you want to use. So real quick, and I'm about to show you an example of the code and the next thing. So CSS are declarations, selectors and declarations. I actually need to correct that as a typo before I send the final to you. I'm sorry, Carol. So here I'll look at it on the screen instead. So right here we have the selector. In this case, it's HTML-element. Okay, that's the selector. What that means is this rule is going to be applied to whatever matches the selector. Okay, now if you're feeling a little lost right now, we're going to go into a working WordPress site in a few minutes. So I'll get to show you a little bit about that. And I'm also going to show you how these are applied in Google too, or using Google Chrome. And then underneath, you have a property and a value inside these curly braces. And that is a CSS declaration. It's a very simple one. So selector, property, and value. So some conventions. All CSS should be written in lowercase. Okay, we said that a couple months ago about HTML2. Always close your rules. So remember how I showed you the little curly brace? Yeah, make sure you always put that at the end. If you don't, it'll break your code. Whereas maybe in HTML you could get away with it. Selectors and rules should belong on their own lines. They don't actually have to be. Whitespace doesn't matter in your CSS code. But we humans need to read this and interpret this. And more importantly, your clients that you're being paid to produce this product for, your clients are one day going to take over this. And if they can't read it, or the person they hire to make a change to their site can't read it, you're taking away from them some integrity, or you're losing some integrity and giving them something that's not human readable. So it's recommended that they belong on their own lines. And in all my examples, you'll see that each of those are on their own line. So a property ends with a colon, and a declaration ends with a semicolon. And then, unlike in HTML, nothing is nested, but for good readability, you can indent. Okay, so here is a very, very basic CSS set of rules. So we have P, so it's selecting P, and I'll explain that's an element. That's the same as your paragraph tag. And then see how we open the curly brace. So now on a new line, we're going to say that the color is red, and that's referencing the text color. So we're going to close this curly brace, and notice there's your colon and semicolon, like I said. So then we're going to close that curly brace. We're going to go to a new line, have a new selector of A. What are A? What does A? What is an A element? A link, an anchor. And so those are going to have a color of lime. This is really an ugly-looking Christmassy website. And then A with a colon for hover means, so whenever you hover over your link, we're going to change the color to green. Yeah, I was hoping that, like, putting my arms up, audience interaction. Okay, so selectors. Let's make our code pretty by being specific with selectors. So selectors help you target the HTML from your code. So WordPress is mostly making all the HTML that is in our code. A little bit of it we might write, like when making a text widget. A little of it, if we're developing our own theme, we might write. But for the most part, WordPress is really good about making our HTML for us. Many users of WordPress will not ever need to know that much about HTML. So, but that said, never need to know about writing it, I mean. But that said, if you want to change the color of something, you should be able to figure out how to make your rule apply to that piece of HTML. And so we'll talk a little bit about how that is, and we're going to use selectors. So with the right combination, you can target very, very specifically. With the wrong combination, you can change every piece of text in your entire website to be an ugly color of fuchsia and not realize it. So we do want to be careful. So let's see three, and I say actually, well, five, of the most common ways to select. So the first is the element selector. So notice how I put element in the less than and greater than signs. Elements are the same that you are selecting essentially what is in your HTML. So every HTML tag that's inside those less than or equal than signs can be selected in CSS with just its name without those little greater than or less than signs. So an HTML element, rule definition. So body is a great example. Width 100%. That's actually automatic, but you might want to specify that. How about a P tag for paragraph? Font family, Times New Roman. That's how you would select those. And I'm sorry, I know you guys over here probably can't see. I'm probably blocking part of the screen there. So the element selectors, very, very common. So class and div selectors. So how many of you guys have ever read an output of HTML and you've seen class or ID? Pretty common. Those two attributes of an HTML tag basically were created for interaction with CSS. They have a couple other applications, like in JavaScript, but they were created mostly for that interaction with CSS. So if you want to target something with a specific class name, you put a dot, then the class name, and now let's open our little squiggly brace, put our properties and our values. All right. Target something with a specific ID. We're going to put an, ready for, we call it a hashtag because of the Twitter generation. Hashtag, ID name, fun fact, that's actually called an octothorpe. It's a very fun fact. Used to be put in building plans to explain how they would build a roof. Octothorpe. I don't know why, but it is. So hashtag, ID name. That's how you select with those IDs and classes. So very, very common in your real code, okay? And then the last most common pair are descendant and child selectors. So in this case, I have to use some real HTML. So I'm going to stand over here. Okay. So in this case, we're using an HTML example. We have an unordered list with the ID of menu. And then there are four menu items. Underneath the third menu item, there's a submenu. So we're going to, before we close this list item, we're going to open a new unordered list with two list items of sub items 1 and 2. And then there you go. We close the unordered list and close that whole list item and go on with our next one. So coming over here to the CSS, a descendant selector will be an element or a class or an ID with a space followed by the next one that it selects. So the best way to read these is actually right to left. So let's read this selector. All list items inside an unordered list. All list items inside an unordered list. So any rules, properties, and values that you put underneath this selector is going to apply to every list item. These as well as these. Okay? So now, I am on the internet quite a bit. Those submenus are usually looking just a little different visually so that our users can understand that it's a submenu, right? So we might want to make those look different, or make the ones up top look different. So, in this one, reading it from the right to left, all list items that are a child of menu ID. So this one is only going to select menu items 1, 2, 3, and 4, but not sub-item 1 and 2. How are we feeling? So, that's, and I'm going to say this again, the best way to read a CSS rule is to read it from right to left. It's how you can understand and catch how it structures into your HTML. So, if we wanted to target, make that first menu dark blue and the submenu light blue, that's how we would do that. We would describe all the menu items up here and say that they're light blue, and then down here, make it dark blue. So, I'm going to say, I'm going to read a kind of complicated example, but just to get an idea. So how many of you guys use Genesis? Stock Genesis themes drive me crazy because every one of the main items, your header, your footer, your wrap, your main content, they all have a wrap item underneath. So header has a div class wrap. Cool. But the content tag has a different named wrap. And I forget that sometimes there's a wrap for content sidebar, or they name it, what exactly is it? It's content, the wrap name changes based on how many columns you use. How about that? So in order to select every wrap, what I do is I say that if the class includes the name of wrap and it is a child of anything that's a child of site container, select it. So that's what that means. So if the class name includes wrap and it's a child of anything that's a child of the site container, that is like the one rule to select every wrap in Genesis. Because I have gone through so many Genesis sites and seen people trying to select that wrap with its own rule, and it's like, well, it's the same. We want all of our content to be centered. Why should we have to write 6 different lines to make that work? So that's the one rule, select them all. So the last big idea in, yes?
A lot of those nested, there's like the ID, there's like ID 3, 4, they're all different. I want to do an ID, I want to select all the IDs. They're all kind of unique.
There's like 30, I'm going to show you a resource for like all 30 of the something selectors in CSS, and if you can show me an example afterward, I'll see if I can help you write the rule for it. So in the name of CSS, we got cascading styled sheets. So these are the two big ideas that make CSS really, really useful, inheritance and the cascade. So rules with the same selector, but later in the code, take precedence. So if you think about looking at a waterfall, whatever is at the bottom is more important than whatever is at the top. It cascades down. The more specific your selectors go, regardless of location in the code, they take precedence. So basically, make something more specific and you go back to the top of the waterfall. Okay? So then if you made something more specific of that, go back to the top of the waterfall. So we're going to, the specificity affects the cascade. So if you have two rules of equal specificity, the one at the bottom takes precedence. So this is where you can come in and change a specific paragraph in a whole body of text. If more specific rules applies, the declarations, so your property and values, declarations from earlier rules are inherited unless overridden. Okay, so say that we have a paragraph, say that we say at the top of our document that all paragraphs have a font family of times. And later on, we say that all paragraphs inside the blog text
are dark gray. We don't need to tell that rule that's making it dark gray that the font should be times, because it's inheriting it from the earlier rule. Okay? The only time we would want to explain the font name is if we wanted to change it. So the more specific a rule is, it only you're looking to override, not necessarily set. Because if it isn't set before, you're going to receive what was set before. Like I said, this is some. So let's read some code. All right. I'm reading from a custom Genesis style sheet. And you're going to find that in the style sheet for almost any website, the beginning of a style sheet is going to set those things that go at the top of the cascade, the rules that might not ever be reset. So for instance, the base font, because we're using the body selector, so all the content on your website that is visible to the user is visible after that body tag. So we're telling that all the text in this website is going to be crimson text. Yep. So now we might go in and change them in the headers, and I'll show you where we might do that, but we're setting that rule really early. So that's going to be inherited by everything else unless we overwrite it. Okay? Color, meaning text color, is RGB 000, or black. Font size, 16 pixels. Line height is 1.2, so it's 1.2 of the font size. Font weight, that's how bold it is. 400 is actually normal. I will say, when you read my code, I could do this and have it be correct. I'm just nerdy and I do the 400 because I can. So let's look at this. So here, A for anchor, text decoration, none. Now, browsers will take image links and put a border around them. We hate that. Those of us who value good design do not want borders around our images. And here also, anytime that I have, and that's actually reset up above, but also all my images, whenever I give them a link, I want them to not have that margin. So I do -4 pixels. So that's an example. There's your first example of a descendant. So any image inside of an A is a descendant right there. All my paragraphs have a bottom margin of 24 pixels, so two lines. My strong tag, we were talking about that semantic HTML, it's going to have a higher font weight, which 700 could be equal to bold. Another option, bolder. It's very fun. So let's scroll down a little bit. So we did this a lot. I did a lot of that. All of my headers. So here's a good example of inheritance. So H1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and 6. All of them are going to have a color. All of them are going to have a sans serif font, in this case, Mully. All of them are going to be uppercase. But don't we normally make our headers be bigger in text? Well, I come over here and I use this. So now H1 is going to be overridden. It's farther down the waterfall of a font size of 44. So it's farther down the waterfall, font size 44. And because of inheritance, it's going to get all of this too. Okay? So H2, font size of 34, plus all of this. And then I don't really use the different sizes for the smaller guys, so font size is 16, I just say, and all of that. Dum-da-dum-da-dum. So now, show you something a little more complicated. Go to it, please. Of course, I spell it wrong. Come on.
Okay, of course it won't do that. Where are my menus? I apologize, guys. I need to find... Here we go. So now, we front-end developers are going to spend a lot of time working on our user experience. Those menus are the most important thing. And I find that about 20% of my CSS code is messing with menus. A little bit more if we have custom menus in the footer, as well as the header, as well as the sidebar. So here, I have everything in this header interact menu, as I'm calling it. Interact being our wonderful social media. So inside header, there's only one thing of menu, so I'm able to let let WordPress give the class name of .menu and be able to use it. Now, WordPress gives the class name of menu to anywhere we use a custom menu. So if I were to just have just .menu, that would change for every menu on my site. But I know that if I give it the header, and header is an HTML5 element, that's the element of header. Yeah, that's the HTML5 element. So it's this in the code, which I'm sorry, because that is exit. Okay. So that's what it is in code. It's the HTML5 element of header. So the class of menu under header is going to be text aligned right. The menu items are going to be in line block and left. So now, here's a great example of using inheritance to make your code cleaner. All of my anchors inside my menus have a font size of 0. That's weird. Why would I not want my font to be visible? Including to go on and give it a color and a text even. But they're 0. They're not visible. Okay. So did you know that you can write an anchor href equals tel and then a phone number? And if you make this in your menu items, that it is interactive for phones. So when you're doing your mobile sites on a desktop site, unless it has like a Google Voice plugin, it doesn't show as anything except just a regular link. But on a mobile site, it shows up as a link for the telephone. So cool thing. So in this case, my selector is in my header. Anchors with an href attribute that starts with telephone, I'm going to give it its font size back. And I'm also going to give it some spacing and some color. Okay. And I put a note here, important, because I want to override mobile OS's colors for that, because I like it looking pretty. So right now, all the rest of my items, and I'm going to show you what this looks like in person in a minute. All the rest of my items still don't have any font size. So, using a selector of the before element, so anchors in the menu class of the header give all these things, and then anchors with an href that includes Facebook give it a content, which is for a custom font. So let's go to Chrome. I'll show you what that looks like. Those rules, this is a project that I did with Greg Taylor. It's featured on Studio Press's website. This is the custom theme that we've been working on. Right there, that's our menu. So we used about 100 lines of code to get rid of the text and replace it with these little interactive icons that are scalable and look clean at any size. So I'm going to show you one of the greatest tools to customizing your CSS right now, in order to also show you what I'm looking at, or what the code looks like. If you right-click, if you're on a computer, or control-click, if you're on a Mac, and do Inspect Element, it brings up the inspector. If you've done a lot of code before, you already know that. This is what WordPress is making for us here.
So you see that we have a menu with the class of menu and Genesis nav menu, because that's what Genesis gives it. And inside here, we have these list items, which are menu items. This one has tell for telephone of their phone number with the text of their phone number in human readable form. And then the next one has a link to Facebook with the text of Facebook. You don't see an image. There's not an image there for the Facebook icon. You just have the word Facebook. That's why I'm making the font size 0. I don't want the word Facebook to show up. I want that to disappear. I'm going to add the icon with CSS. So it disappears, and then it uses the href asterisk selector. So it's looking for a wildcard inside your href to find the word Facebook, because Facebook has to be in the text of the link. And then it's adding this content from a custom font called... yeah, font family icons. So that's kind of a complicated little example, but you can go grab this off of the internet because I put it in a gist.
And it's SEO friendly because Google will read Facebook or whatever it is, even though the person doesn't read it.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. What's my GitHub? Jeremy E. Scott. So that menu, using inheritance and specificity and some cool CSS selectors that were all CSS 2.1, not even CSS 3 selectors, so they're supported by IE 8 and above, we got rid of font, and we added these cool little interactive icons with font, so they are scalable and Retina friendly.
Is icons a Google font?
No. It's... Foundation. You can make custom font packages through Foundation. So, let me show you one of the most important resources, and it's called going to Google and typing CSS selectors. My favorite is the one that comes up called Quirks Mode. And you're going to need to, there's no way I could take an entire college course of like 38 hours inside a classroom and not be able to teach you enough about CSS to that would be retainable to be able to be like super awesome functional at it, because I can't even list every CSS rule. I just say, hey, I've seen this done before. I'm going to go on Google and remind myself what the rule is. So selectors are really easily looked up just by Googling. So, list of selectors. So we talked about the element selector in my presentation, very widely supported. The class selector, so the dot test for a class name. The hashtag test for an ID. We talked about the descendant selector. In my complicated example, a star was select everything. And then multiple classes, and I'm going to show you what that looks like. Hello.world. So good example is if you have dot, a good example for WordPress users, every menu item gets the class of dot menu item. In your menu programming, you can give subclass or you can give additional classes to menu items. So what if you have that like one menu item like contact us or act now that needs to be a different color than the rest of the items on the menu? Menu item dot act now. And the color will be a different color than the rest. And let it inherit everything else. So if you just do dot, dot, just chain your classes, that works as far back as IE6, sort of, IE7 for sure. So the combinators, where we use the child selector, I showed you that one. And then the plus selector is next to, so two things that have to be next to each other. And basically, I could go a long time explaining how each of these work. I don't have the time for that, nor do you guys probably have the stomach for that. But the resources are very easily found. So you saw something that was kind of complicated using kind of complicated selectors, though that were supported in
all the way down to IE7 that made an SEO-friendly social media menu that got rid of the text and replaced it with awesome icons. I knew it could be done, but I had to go to Quirks mode to look at the exact format of the selectors. And so use the W3 schools link that I suggested. Use the W3.org link that I suggested. Look up Quirks mode. These are all great resources. And in this case, this tells you if it works going how far back. IE7 we can already kind of let go of. So everything up here, IE8 supports. It's when we get down into the CSS3 selectors that we start seeing Internet Explorer start to suck again. So, like for instance, in range, and I've never even used half of these because I'm not going to make anything that doesn't work on IE8 yet. So, long story short, there are resources like this out there that can help you use these selectors. And there are also resources out there that can list all the different properties you can apply. But you can go so far as to make your lowercase text in small caps using CSS. You can make the borders round. You can make the transition smooth. You can do a lot of things with the CSS properties that I couldn't even begin to list all the different ones, but they're very easily found. So it's as simple as ways you can... Wow, I love... I love Google suggestions. Ways you can get HIV or pregnant. Okay. Ways you can define color in CSS. Bam, W3 CSS color property on W3 schools. So see, here's the resource. Specifies a color. Look at CSS color values for a complete list of possible color values. Hexadecimals, RGB, RGBA, so that's for partial transparency, HSL, hue saturation and lightness, HSLA, hue saturation, lightness, and alpha for partial transparency, and then cross-browser color names. Wow. There are all these ways you can choose color, including 147 predefined color names with a table of them. Please don't use predefined color names, though. These are not a good idea. They just exist, but that doesn't mean they're right. Just the same as the B tag exists, but you should use strong instead. So I hope that I got you a little bit excited about some of the maybe more advanced possibilities if you do a little bit of research and a little bit of exploration. I hope that I gave you a little bit of an idea of how to put together a couple of CSS rules. I have some time to answer some questions, so I'm going to open the floor to that. And yeah, I hope you guys have fun, even though I know this was much more of a complex topic than my last one. So, questions.
What's the reasoning for not using the predefined names?
They still, even though they say they're cross-browser, they're still displayed somewhat differently. And when you are able to be specific by naming a color either with RGB or HSL or hexadecimal, you have a lot more control over that. You don't have to necessarily let an older browser display medium chartreuse wrong, especially when your clients are expecting you to follow a specific branding style. Use the more specific unnamed names. Yeah?
I wanted to, have you heard of caniuse.com?
Yes, I have, actually.
It's like what you talked about, Quirks mode, except it also contains HTML5. And so you can, yeah, that's it.
Caniuse.com. Cool source. I remember looking at this. I actually haven't used it, though, so I've just seen it in some Twitter feed. Oh, it includes JavaScript, too. Sweet. I'll have to look more over that. Great resource. I can already tell it's a great resource. Calc as a CSS unit value, yeah, I hear that was actually going away. So in this case, it's another way to see, and this is more useful if you're trying to use, like, bleeding edge things. Remember how I said, like, if you use 2.1 2.1 selectors, they're basically all going to be supported, IE8 and above. They don't even test for older versions of Firefox, even though I know they supported it from the outset. So that's a great resource. Thanks, Carol.
When do you use the important tag, like estimation importance? I see that sometimes in the code.
Excellent question. Important tag is important tag creates a whole new cascade from the beginning. And so people use it to ignore the cascade. So it puts, if we wanted to put an important of star, important, so star being select everything, and then said the color was black, important, that would make everything on your website that accepts color, so every piece of text that accepts the color property, black. It would completely blow away the ultimate override. Now, I've used it occasionally, and I think that you saw me use it in the telephone rules, because browsers can add user style sheets, and stock or user style sheets. Browsers can add them in certain places too. So in the case of me using important with tel, the styling for telephone numbers is added after on Safari Mobile. So if I want to make sure that my styling for the telephone links gets used, I threw up an important flag on it. But more often than not, I see important used at the end of a rule, and I'm going to show you guys an example of what it looks like since people are asking. People who throw important up are just being lazy and they're not doing their research to find out where in the CSS their rule is actually being overridden. So it's really a bad practice to use important unless you know exactly why. And I got a hand up. Yes, and whenever possible, turn off. If you're going to do really custom sites, turn off the user settings in your plugin to turn off the imported styles. Because throwing a whole bunch of importance into your code just slows everything down. I mean, it's marginally, but okay. It's going to be the last one because it resets. You can override an important with a more specific important, and it throws out the cascade. It puts everything on. It's this totally new cascade for you. So I'll give you an example. This right here, this rule. So star. So select everything. Color of that would make everything on a website black. Let's go play. We're going to put it in the body tag. So in the body tag, everything needs to be black, and it's going to be important. And actually, that didn't even work. I wonder why. Oh, because it didn't star. Dang it. Oh, it was already black anyway. I don't even know. Can you add custom style? Let me go in. I have to really... maybe this is too complicated for me to try and test right now. Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and go with that.
The question is just, when do you use it?
Yeah, when you use it, if... When you want to override something and you don't have control over it, so it's something that's falling at the bottom of the cascade. So that's a problem with WordPress plugins, is that their custom add-on style sheets sometimes get thrown in after yours. In fact, almost they should be thrown in after yours. But I think of gravity forms. I hate gravity forms. I hate styling gravity forms because they override everything you try and do. They put such a high degree of specificity on their custom style sheet that you have to exactly match their specificity or they always beat you. Styling gravity forms is terrible unless you turn off their style sheet, which is possible on the form settings of a gravity form form. But believe me, it took me weeks to figure that out. So it's not up in your face.
But then you have to style everything.
Style
all the input fields and everything.
Yeah. But if that's okay, styling if you have a client who wants their form to look exactly like that, and they've built this beautiful custom site on specs, and they want their form to look like that, you have to do it.
But sometimes if you just want to override one specific style, otherwise their style sheet is great.
Mm-hmm. You can use important, or you can match their specificity.
matching specificity or being more specific. You can still get to the bottom. You can still get lower on the cascade.
Yeah, but see, they throw
Gravity Forms is terrible. Do not get me wrong. Terrible in their specificity. Terrible in their specificity. I love the structure and the integration. I do not love their style sheet. I turn it off, but that's because I'm comfortable formatting a form. So.
We got a question on selectors.
Mm-hmm.
If you're trying to select a piece statement down inside of a class, how do you do that?
A specific P statement?
Specific piece. Take the first one. Say you got a list of them. You want to grab the first one and change the color of it.
If you want to change just the first paragraph, you can use first child. So that would be P first child. So you could do that. Last child starts work. There's also a last child, which is a CSS3, so it's not widely supported. And there's also an nth child, which is definitely not supported. But first child and last child generally work. I think from IE9, last child works, and IE8, IE7, first child works. First letter also is there too, which is a cool one. First letter, if you have a paragraph and you want to do that like newspaper thing, where the first letter is bigger, you can make like the font size like 200%. And then that first letter is huge, just like in the newspapers or that, you know, old English style book. So there's a lot of cool selectors out there. You'll be surprised what they can be used for. A cool one is, and I use this one quite a bit, but if you have an A, and this is to select A's with an href tag, and then this means at the beginning of the string that follows, end. There's an end. I forget what one it is. Let's just say that's end, but I know it's not. .pdf. Why would you want to have a rule like that? Well, if we add the before, I'm using pseudocode right now, content of a URL of pdf icon.gif. So you know how you have those customers that have downloads on their websites? You can write a rule like that, and look up the selector, please, that selects links to PDFs, so with hrefs that end in .pdf, and I know it's not the percent sign, so don't quote me. I have to look it up if I were to get the exact one. And then with the pseudo class, or with the pseudo of before, so before that link, you're going to add a PDF icon so that user knows they're about to download a PDF. That's a cool selector that is underused. Because a lot of people will do this complicated thing where they'll write the complicated href, blah, 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 and then they'll include your image tag of your icon, and then they'll write the name of the file. Well, that's dumb. Just let CSS do it for you. It's dumb if you know better, and that's what I'm trying to show you is know better. So let's go back to that quirks mode. Where is it? Where is my quirks mode at?
There it is. Yeah.
There it is. Glad I cleaned my history before this. Just kidding. Okay, so where is it? Okay, so attribute $. So $ ends with, so if it ends with .pdf, give it a PDF. If it ends with .doc or .docx, give it a Word document symbol. That's a cool thing. Attribute star, which is the one I was using for the social media list, attribute star is selecting something inside. So if your href includes Facebook, you can select Facebook links and change the icon to be the Facebook icon. Yeah.
So given you use the font, I mean, what's the benefit of using a font icon like you did for the content for your thumbnails instead of using small images?
Have you ever used an iPad 3?
No.
An iPad 3.
The difference.
Oh no, I lost it. An iPad
has a 2x pixel density. It's called Retina. So on a normal screen, when we as developers develop for a 1,000 pixel wide screen, the iPad scales your site, and it's really 2,000 pixels. So all your images, even this, like see this logo? Like if we zoom in really close, it's blurry. But look at how sharp these are. That's because we're using a font image. So they're mathematical images versus pixel images. I'm not very well versed in SVGs and stuff. Yeah, it's scalable vector. So I don't know how they work, but I know that the concept of vector images. It's kind of the same idea. So
vector would be clear.
Clear like this.
So
yeah.
Where are those coming? Where are those defined in the browser? You said Facebook, but where are those images defined?
At import, right? You do that.
Yeah.
At import.
One of the advantages of the icons or fonts for images is that you can do all kinds of cool. Everything you can do with text, CSS, you can do with those graphics. So you can change the color, you can do all kinds of hover stuff, and all that fun stuff that you can convert into the CSS, you can do that.
Here's an example of a couple of icon fonts. So they show you how to use them. That could be a whole presentation. But icon fonts using CSS, yeah.
There's fonts. It's not font fancy. Font. Yes, font awesome. Is that a tool that you would use then? You would import font awesome for a lot of these?
Yeah, I have a WordPress.
Do you really?
Awesome. This guy's name is Jeremy, too.
Jeremy's a cool name tonight.
So, other questions, guys? CSS is a very big topic. There are very big books on CSS, and there are very big websites documenting CSS. And I've been using CSS for 8 years, so it's very hard to take 2 hours and condense 8 years of practice and following the trends and to condense it into, you know, a 1 hour quick talk with you guys. But my goal here was to give you a basic understanding of how you can select in a WordPress. So this is a WordPress right here. I mean, this is a WordPress site. How you can select things in WordPress and use your menu options and use your use what WordPress gives you to make cool CSS. And so my hopeful takeaways is use Google and right-click inspect element. Those are my biggest things that I hope you guys to be able to take away. And yeah, I enjoyed getting a second opportunity to speak for you guys today. So, and there you go.
Thank you. Did you have my book? Oh.
Do you want the microphone, Carol?
Yes, please.
Yeah, Carol showed me this really, it's pretty. So many tech books are fail because they don't look pretty. But she has a pretty book that she brought and showed me, and it made me happy for a few minutes.
It's HTML and CSS. That's what it's called. And it's design and build websites. I mean, this is like, so very simple. I'll pass this around. But what I like about this is other coding books, I mean, your eyes cross. And this one did take a lot of time and a lot of energy making things pretty and readable. The graphic designers in here will appreciate the white space and how they've made it very user-friendly. This one is HTML and CSS, and then they are coming out with one that's not out yet. I actually have it on pre-order for jQuery and JavaScript. So there's going to be another companion manual just like this for jQuery and JavaScript. So I'll just pass that around if you want to take a look. And thank you. Another round of applause for Jeremy. As you can tell, it's a really difficult subject. It's so complicated. There's so much going on. But I think Jeremy has a really good knack for trying to break it down, even in a really complicated way. Or even complicated things to break it down in a simple way.